Thank you. Thank you very much. I am deeply honored to be performing at the Taj Mahal, as I am deeply honored to be part of India's celebration of the 50th anniversary of its independence. It has been a dream of mine to visit India and present my music, to be doing it for the first time in this magnificent and magical place makes it a once-in-a-lifetime unforgettable event for me. For the past year and a half, I've been isolated in the studio, creating, composing the music in anticipation of this event, and it's during this event that the new album will be created. 我很高兴到北京来。 And this is all the Chinese I know for now. But I promise when I come back next year, we could have learned a lot more. It is indeed a great honor for me to be performing in the Forbidden City. It is one of the greatest architectural achievements in the world. And it is perhaps man's attempt to imagine heaven on earth. For the past few weeks, I have been touring China, and I have been deeply moved by the warmth and by the acceptance of the Chinese people. And I know that when I return home, I would have been changed by my experiences in China. So, we will continue now with a new composition. This one is called Renegade. Thank you.
Barry Eustache on saxophone and flutes. And Karen Briggs on violin.
I'd like to introduce to you now one of the newest members in our band. His name is Ramon Stagnaro. He's from Peru and he plays the guitar. That's a very small guitar you got there, Ramon. I told you not to wash it today. I think it must have shrunk. But not really. It's a very beautiful South American instrument called the charango. It's a very happy instrument. Ramon introduced me to this instrument a few months ago, and I just decided to open the next piece of music using the charango. This one is called Waltz in 7/8. Thank you. Leo Freeman on keyboards. I remember when I was young, my father would take me for these long walks up on the Greek mountains. And during those times, he would try to teach me about life. He was always trying to teach us simplicity and appreciation for nature. And he liked to say that the best things in life are available to everyone because they're inside us, like truth, imagination, creativity, love, kindness, compassion. So you see, greatness has nothing to do with success or money or possessions. The next piece of music celebrates the greatness that's inherent in all of us. It will feature our conductor, Mr. Armin Anasian, on violin. And it's called Tribute.
Thank you. Lisa Pino on trumpet.
The next piece of music, believe it or not, was inspired by a nightingale. I often listen to nature because I learn balance from listening to nature. I remember a few years ago I was in Venice, Italy, and one of these birds kept coming by my window every sunset, and she proceeded to sing her song. And it was so beautiful, I was completely mesmerized by it. These birds have such a tremendous vocabulary and rhythms and melodies. And I thought, what a pity that we couldn't communicate, we couldn't speak each other's language. It wasn't until many years later, when I was introduced to the Chinese flute, that I realized that this instrument, particularly in the higher registers, has a lot of the tonal characteristics of the nightingale. And so I decided to write a song using the Chinese flute. The song will begin with our Venezuelan friend, whom you met a little earlier tonight, Pedro Eustache, playing the Chinese flute. It's called Nightingale, and I'd like to dedicate it to you. Thank you. Yeah. Of all the forces that are exerted on us over our lifetime, at least for me, love has been the most powerful of all. As our population increases, our planet becomes smaller and smaller. It's therefore very important that we all learn how to love and accept each other. Whenever that's not possible, at least learn how to tolerate one another. I learned that very valuable lesson early on in life because of changing cultures. I moved from Greece to the United States, and to this day, people ask me, are you Greek or are you American? I'm a human being, just like all of us. And then I'm Greek, or American, or Chinese, or Indian. We must come to understand and realize that there are as many ways to live life as there are people on this planet. 2,500 years ago, Socrates said that the perfect human being is all human beings put together. It is a collective. It is a we. It is all of us together that make perfection. The next piece of music talks all about that. And I would like to dedicate it to Shah Jahan and Mumtaz Mahal and to the architects and engineers and sculptors that loved the pieces of marble into this architectural wonder of beauty we call the Taj Mahal. And also, I would like to dedicate it to all the people in India who loved this concert into existence and thus enabling us to send a very powerful and much needed message around the world, a message of love, unity, acceptance, and tolerance. The song will begin once again with our Venezuelan friend Pedro Eustache playing a 2,500-year-old Armenian instrument called the duduk. It's called Love Is All. Thank you.
Graham Johnson.
You know, in looking for the best musicians in the world, I ended up with the United Nations. The musicians in this orchestra represent a great many of the world's nations, and without them, I couldn't have my music materialize. I would like to introduce to you now our symphony orchestra. Okay, the next piece of music is a celebration. It celebrates the bond that exists among all people. And I know as our cities become larger, busier, faster, noisier, we tend to go numb to the fact that we're all connected after all. So why don't you join us in the celebration? This one is called Nicky Nana, We're One.
Thank you.
am completely consumed by it. First, I know what the emotion is, what the song is going to feel like, before I know what the instruments, what the rhythm, what the speed, what the sound, what the melody, anything. Music can communicate such delicate and subtle emotions that are next to impossible to describe with words. I feel it's a very consistent and very enjoyable album. If I do my job right, the listener should experience the level that I was at while I was writing the music. I hope that people will enjoy this new album. I certainly enjoyed making it. It's been a lot of fun. Creating for me is one of the most powerful, deliberate acts that a human being can do. It is one of the most important reasons to exist, in my mind. It fulfills me. Music can communicate such delicate and subtle emotions that are next to impossible to describe with words. And as such, it gives me tremendous ability to talk to people. And if I do my job right, the listener should experience the level that I was at while I was writing the music. The way I felt when I created that piece, when someone listens to it, should be able to feel the same, if it's done right. In order for me to create, there's an intense focus that has to take place. You got to stop the input from society. You got to stop the bombardment. All the information that comes in, the phone calls, and somebody's birthday, and Christmas is coming, and it's your birthday, and it's, you got to pay the telephone bill, and the electric bill, and the insurance, and so on, and the car broke down, and all that stuff has to go away. It does not exist. That's not so easy to do. I've learned over the years to do it very well. And once you're clear and you stop that tremendous input, all of a sudden you hear yourself talk. And you can go into a place where creativity has no end, where the music lies, and it's as many songs as you like to do. I can close my eyes and hear entire compositions, one after the other, and they're unending when you're in that place. The only requirement is that you do not judge it. You don't have an opinion. You don't say, this is a nice one, this is a rhythmic one, this is a fast one, this is a slow one, or this is a bad one. Because as soon as you do that, you're outside that room, looking in. And if you do that, then you can't create. You're gone. You're outside that moment that people call that spark, that moment. I think athletes may refer to it as the zone. And that may be a way to communicate that level. It's a magical place. After I finished the last tour, which was about 110 concerts, I was very tired, to say the least. And tired is not the right word. Exhausted. And I was in a very bad place, dangerous place, actually, to be. A very, very difficult place. It's a place where you have everything you want, but you're not happy. And it does not feel very good. So the first thing I did is I packed up and I went to Greece and stayed with my parents.
until I felt that I was healed. And the way I knew is one morning I woke up and looked at the sunrise and I was happy. And then I knew, okay, you're healed. Now you can begin thinking about what you want to do next. I traveled for a few more months after that. So when I got here and it was time to record, I was bursting with ideas. And I'd forgotten how beautiful the feeling is when you create, when you actually make something out of nothing and it just lives and breathes and you succeed at it. The happiness I get from that and the fulfillment, I'd forgotten. It's quite important to me. The water's been a big part of my life. I grew up right next to it. I spent most of my days in it when I was a kid. Just being able to look on an open ocean where your eyes don't focus at 10 yards or 20 yards, but they focus at infinity. It's a part that, of me that I missed when I left Greece. I missed it very much, and it cost me a lot. And every summer I would go back home and I would see the place again and I would say, ah, that's what my soul needs. That's what I love. I love this place because it reminds me of Kalamata. It reminds me of where I was born. Similar temperature, very close to the ocean. And if you're born like that, and I didn't leave there until I was 18 years old, it's in you. It's in your bones. You know, you don't get rid of it. So as I traveled and I went to the bigger cities and so on, I left the water and I went all the way around, all the way as far north as Minnesota, and came right back to the water. And I love it. Now I spend my times between here and Greece. I essentially have remained a small town boy. I like simplicity, and I don't like a lot of noise around. This place is spectacular. It's state-of-the-art digital recording studio, which was a dream of mine to have. I've never had such good facility before. But again, I got to keep in mind, this is just technology. What's really special about it is just the atmosphere. The acoustic design, first of all, just the way it sounds, we took special care. But also the atmosphere, the way everything is designed, the way I like it, the way I like it to look when I'm working. So it's pretty inspiring place to be. Music does not come from this place. The music comes from here, comes from my mind. But the tools are wonderful. What this studio enabled me to do is fantastic. Took a long time to build. Had a lot of people working on this. Took a couple of years to design it and build it. But now, hopefully, I'll be working in here for the next decade or so. I came in with an open mind. I had no idea what the album was going to sound like. I didn't even know if there's going to be an album inside me. And I'm always, all my albums, I've done 12, 13 albums now. Every time I go in to do an album, I'm always a little afraid and always skeptical. I'm not sure what the next album is going to be like, what the ideas are going to be. Will I have new ideas? Am I going to just go in there and repeat myself and so on? But after I begin working, from the first day, that same night, I just go, why was I questioning myself? I work on one song at a time, and I'm completely consumed by it. First, I know what the emotion is, what the song is going to feel like, before I know what the instruments, what the rhythm, what the speed, what the sound, what the melody, anything. It's just an emotion, a pure emotion. I know what it should feel like. Then the choices become a lot easier in choosing sounds, rhythms, and melodies that describe that emotion. The concert site is really submerged underwater probably for 6 months out of the year. It doesn't exist. And it's once in a while the Yamuna River backs up a little bit and leaves this sandy beach, which we had to turn into a concert site for about 10,000-15,000 people. And carpet the whole area so you don't see any sand anywhere. Built a stage on it. Built two bridges across the river. So that people could cross and come to the concert site. And it was just a small city. Taj Mahal has never been lit at night. We had these 100 million watt lights go on. The whole place was like daylight. So the birds began flying. All of a sudden, we start seeing these huge birds going overhead. It's pretty amazing. The one thing that really surprised me about Chinese audiences was I was told that they're very cool, calm, and collected. They will applaud, but they're not going to stand up and cheer. And don't expect too much from them, but don't take it personally. They just are like that. Couldn't be farther from the truth. These people are warm. They love music. They express themselves. They've made as much noise as any American audience has ever made or any South American audience and so on. As far as the government was concerned, I was treated perfectly. They changed nothing that I wanted to say during the concert or do during the concert. I was allowed to perform maybe 400 yards away from Tiananmen Square 4 days before the anniversary of the Tiananmen Square incident. So they were tolerant. They were accepting because I was accepting towards them. But I was allowed to do my concert and say the same things that I say anywhere else in the world. And I could see China is such a big country, it's a billion too. There's a lot of people. There's a lot of people who are not educated. There is cities that are extremely developed, like Guangzhou and Beijing and Shanghai. And then if you go inland, you go into places to where people are maybe lived 200-300 years ago. I can see how Tian Zemin has a big problem in trying to move an entire nation of that magnitude to any direction. So I sympathize with him. I think the website is a very powerful tool. It's the future. And I think it's, besides my music, you know, transmitting my music, I think it's a very powerful tool when it's going to reshape the planet as we know it, because now human beings will be able to communicate directly with each other. And even though, yes, it's good for me, I can put my music on it, it could be exposed to a lot of people that normally I wouldn't be able to be exposed to, or I wouldn't have access to, I always look beyond that. I think the fact that anyone can talk to anyone, and if they can't do it right this minute, in the next decade they will be able to, will change the way we think about each other. And I think it'll bring people closer together. It'll make it more difficult for the leaders of our societies to engage in nasty activities clandestinely and so on. I think it'll just reshape the whole planet. My audience has been great towards me. Even people I meet on the street, they tend to be respectful. The letters that I get from my fans are sometimes move me to tears. And that's, I'm not exaggerating. There are stories that tell me. You know, the letters are not so much when we love your music, and they're not usually centered around that, even though they usually pay me a compliment of one sort or another. It's about their feeling. Most of them begin by, I've never written a fan letter before, but I thought you should know that. That's probably one of the most common fan letters written to me. And then they begin to tell me a story of how my music relates to their life, how it helps them go through one situation or another. For example, people who go through chemotherapy and the pain of chemotherapy and how much the music helps them endure the pain and be uplifted and go through the battle. The music has been used for a myriad of other reasons. For example, when people lose a loved one, whether it's a wife or a father or son and so on. And I never had any idea that I would be affecting people in that way. And it's amazing. Pregnant mothers write me and say, you know, they play the music for the baby. They put the speaker right on their tummy and play the music. I guess it calms the baby down, I don't know. Or they play it when they give birth to their children, or they play it during funerals or weddings. And as an artist, to have this kind of connection with human beings, any human beings, that your art could be used in some of the most important parts of our lives. It is a confirmation. I hope that people will enjoy this new album. I certainly enjoyed making it. It's been a lot of fun. It took me about a year to do it, and I feel it's a very consistent and very enjoyable album. I think it could be used in a lot of different parts of your life. It does not demand your attention, your undivided attention, but I think it has a very strong mood that's consistent. I just hope people enjoy it. Water has been a big part of my life. I grew up right next to it. I spent most of my days in it when I was a kid. I love this place because it reminds me of Kalamata. It reminds me of where I was born. If you're born like that, and I didn't leave there until I was 18 years old, it's in you. It's in your bones. This place is spectacular. It's state-of-the-art digital recording studio, which was a dream of mine to have. What the studio enabled me to do is fantastic. Took a long time to build. Had a lot of people working on this. Took a couple of years to design it and build it. But now, hopefully, I'll be working in here for the next decade or so. Creating for me is one of the most powerful, deliberate acts that a human being can do. Music, I feel, is the most powerful and very direct language known to man. It can communicate across borders and language barriers, and essentially it bypasses logic and speaks directly to your soul. Music can communicate such delicate and subtle emotions that are next to impossible to describe with words. If I do my job right, the listener should experience the level that I was at while I was writing the music. I took a year off after the Taj Mahal and the Forbidden City concerts. After I finished the last tour, which was about 110 concerts, I was very tired, to say the least. So the first thing I did is I packed up and I went to Greece and stayed with my parents until I felt that I was healed. I traveled a lot. I went back to a lot of the countries that I toured at, but this time I had time to stay and drink their wine and breathe the air, eat their food, and just be with the people, and filled up with experiences, which I needed. So when I got here and it was time to record, I was bursting with ideas. I came in with an open mind. I had no idea what the album was going to sound like. I work on one song at a time, and I'm completely consumed by it. First, I know what the emotion is, what the song is going to feel like, before I know what the instruments, what the rhythm, what the speed, what the sound, what the melody, anything. I started a year ago. It was the most effortless album that I have ever done. It is a new direction. I think I have learned a lot in the past 20 years of working. It is very different, obviously, than the Acropolis and the tribute albums, which were concert albums. I hope that people will enjoy this new album. I certainly enjoyed making it. I've learned a lot the last couple of years. It was actually fairly difficult years, with the exception of recording the album. There was a lot to be learned as far as understanding where I've been, where my career is at, what is the meaning of all this, what have I been doing for the last 15 years, why have I worked so hard, and essentially what is the meaning, and trying to understand it and put it into perspective. And I feel maybe now I'm putting it into a very good perspective, and thus I'm free. and I'm happy, and I hope it continues like that, because then I'm going to want to write a lot more music.